या नीलेश? हेलो, पार्टिसिपेंट क्यों 6 जन देखा कौन से? बीजू म्यूट छे, म्यूट छे, तू म्यूट
છ પેનલિસ્ટ
આવી ગયા બધા?
ના ના, એટલે એ આપણે એને
અચ્છા ઓટોમેટિક આવે. હા, કોઈ જોઈન નથી આવ્યો?
જોઈન થઈ ગયા લાગે છે. કોઈ વેબિનાર સ્ટાર્ટ કરી નાખ્યો?
મેં કર્યો વેબિનાર સ્ટાર્ટ.
એ સ્ટાર્ટ ના કરાય?
અરે બાપરે, તો હવે
કોઈ કઈ ના થાય, ઇટ્સ લાઈવ થઈ ગયો. કલી
કરતો. અરે બાપરે,
હા, કોઈ દિવસ સ્ટાર્ટ બટન પર નહીં દબાવવાનું કોઈ દિવસ.
અરે મને એમ કે કોઈ કરતું હતું સ્ટાર્ટ વેબિનાર.
Present is present activities. He is practicing as an advocate in the field of direct taxes, indirect taxes, Benami law, corporate and allied laws, as a practice leader of DHJ legal and appearing in Supreme Court, High Court and tribunals. He was practicing as a chartered accountant since last 19 years in the field of direct tax, litigation, consultancy and transfer pricing as proprietor of DHJ and Associates. He was partner in Messrs. CBK and Associates Chartered Accountants. He was a co-author of book on Income Computation Disclosure Standards, a practical guide published by Bombay Chartered Accountants Society. He was a co-author of book on Recovery of Taxes published by Chamber of Tax Consultants. He was co-author of budget publication by Bombay Chartered Accountants Society. He got Best Lecture Award from CS Tax Practitioners Association Mumbai for delivering lecture on impact of Hawala purchases on income tax assessment in the year 2014. He has been the chairman of Direct Tax Committee and member of Managing Council and Law and Representation Committee of Chamber of Tax Consultants. He has contributed paper on deemed income provisions in RRC of Chamber of Tax Consultants in the year 2019 at Lucknow. He was involved in teaching in the subject of direct tax to CA final students. He was past assistant editor of the monthly journal published by Chamber of Tax Consultants. He is a faculty in certificate course on taxation of cooperative societies organized by ICA at Kolkata, Bangalore and Hubli. He was a faculty in a webcast on taxation of cooperative societies organized by our institute. He is regularly contributing articles in a professional magazine like BCA Journal, Income Tax Review, Taxman Corporate, Professional Today, CCS Direct Tax Online, Outlook Money. He is regularly delivering lectures at various study centers and professional seminars. He has conducted several programs on compensation structuring for Bombay Chamber of Commerce. With this, we request you to accept e-memento from our study circle as a token of our love and affection. We also contribute rupees 500 towards CABA fund on your behalf. Over to you, sir. Please, you can start your presentation, sir.
Thank you, Jatin bhai, for the nice introduction. Nilesh bhai, respected Sharad bhai, and other conveners of Borivali Central CPE Study Circle, professional brothers, fellow professionals, seniors in profession, the new entrants, and ladies and gentlemen, very good evening to you all. At the outset, let me thank the conveners of the study circle and also my dear friend Lalit Panchal to give me this opportunity to speak on the very relevant topic in the current scenario. There are lots of reopening notices have been issued. I hope in this session of 2 hours, I will be meeting the expectations of the audience and try to give my thoughts on two aspects of the subject. One, how the new reassessment procedure is going to take place for income escaping assessment as well as assessment of surge cases. And also the other aspect as to the validity of the notices which are issued after 31st of March 2021. before starting the presentation, let me also wish and pray that in this difficult situation of the pandemic, which we are facing since last now around 1.5 year, I wish and pray that we all and our family members and our associates, friends, relatives, we all sail through this and life is back to normal, so that I get the opportunity to come to Borivali and address you all in a physical manner rather than this e-manner of webinars. And we are back to our normal life of seminars, where we are able to also meet and have a fellowship with our fellow members. I'll share my screen. Is it visible?
Yes, visible. Yeah.
So the topic is assessment of surge cases and reassessment under the new regime. Basically, the hot topic right now going on is reassessment. So some people might wonder why this surge cases assessment is also combined with this. The reason is quite simple. A special assessment procedure for surge, which was hitherto in place in the Income Tax Act, has now been done away with. And the assessment of surge cases is now combined with the normal reopening of the cases, with only few changes specifically applicable to surge cases. So earlier we were dealing with section 147, which dealt with only assessment of income escaped assessment, and we had a special regime under section 153A to 153D dealing with assessment of surge cases. From 1st of April 2021, these have been combined, and only the sections dealing with reassessment, section 147 to section 152, they only will be dealing with also assessment of surge cases. Only few differences between assessment of surge cases and the normal reopening. So all the important sections, section 147, 148, 149 and 151, four very, very important sections dealing with reassessment. These sections have been substituted by a new section. Along with that, a new section 148A has been inserted, and these sections will be dealing with two aspects: one, income escaping assessment, and another, assessment of surge cases. These amendments will take effect from 1st of April 2021, and the moment actually when we read Finance Act and when we see the effective date 1st of April 21, normally the question immediately comes in the mind as to from which assessment year this new provision is going to be made applicable. As far as our today's topic is concerned, assessment of surge cases and assessment of reassessment new regime, this particular question as to from which assessment year these new provisions will apply is a very complex question. I'll try to answer it in the course of my presentation and discussion. So what is there in store is a new section 147, and I have reproduced the part of that section 147, that if any income of an assessee has escaped assessment for any assessment year, the assessing officer may, subject to the provisions of section 148 to 153, assess or reassess such income and also any other income which has escaped assessment and which comes to his notice subsequently in the course of the proceeding, or recompute the loss or depreciation allowance or any other allowance as the case may be for such assessment. So if you closely see this section 147 with the earlier section 147, as such it looks to be very similar, but a very fundamental and important difference is absence of the word reasons to believe. In the earlier section, the foremost requirement was if the assessing officer has reasons to believe that income has escaped assessment, then he may proceed with reassessment. But the new section does not use the word reasons to believe. It only says if an income of an assessee has escaped assessment, what will be the impact of the absence of the word reasons to believe, and what is meant by an income of an SSE escaping assessment, we'll see a little later after 10 minutes or so. At this stage, I have reproduced this part only to see, say that how fundamental changes are going to be made in this entire scheme of reassessment. So as we discussed, search-related assessment proceedings have been discontinued, and the explanatory memorandum gives the reason for this, that it is to reduce the litigation. As the members must be aware, that prior to 2003, there was a different system of assessment of search cases, which was replaced in the year 2003. And the system of earlier block assessment of search cases that was replaced by a new regime of assessment under Section 153A of the person searched, and under Section 153C of any other person who has not been searched, but either some assets belonging to that person or some documents pertaining to that particular person are found in the course of search of one person. These sections, according to the explanatory memorandum, did not give the desired result in spite of doing away with the scheme of block assessment where much litigation was there. The explanatory memorandum says that this replacement of block assessment by this new regime of 153A to 153C has not been very encouraging. So much litigation is prevailing even in this regime. And therefore, they feel that a scheme of assessment which has been in progress, which has been in existence for almost two decades, from 2003 to 2021. So 18 long years of existence of a scheme, where almost all the issues of 153A to 153C were judicially settled by various High Court and Supreme Court. But this regime has now been done away with. And the reason given is to reduce litigation. So accordingly, the assessment proceeding relating to search, survey and seizure will now be embedded within the ambit of Section 147 itself. So the cutoff date is 31st of March 2021. Any searches initiated on or after 1st of April 21 will be covered by the new regime. Search initiated up to 31st of March 21 will be governed by the old regime of Section 153A to 153C. So the moment a search is initiated on or after 1st of April 21, there is no separate assessment regime, and it will be done, conducted in the normal manner of a reassessment. The explanatory memorandum also gives a reason for this entire overhaul in the changes in the scheme of reassessment. And two main reasons are given in the explanatory memorandum. One is the use of technology. They're saying because of the use of technology, the relevant information about escapement of income, either from third party transaction in reporting in the form of AIR, which is now known as SFTR, Statement of Financial Transaction or Reportable Account under Section 285BA. So the information of third party transaction and also from the external agencies, like GST agencies or enforcement directorate, etc., etc. Because of the use of technology and artificial intelligence, the information about escapement of income is readily available to the department, and therefore they've introduced a regime where the reassessment would be information driven rather than based on the satisfaction of the AO as to the escapement of income. So it is claimed indirectly that it is an attempt to move from an subjective approach of reopening to an objective approach of reopening. Only time will tell how far this stated objective will be achieved. Even the second objective, and in a lighter way, the second objective which they claim that to reduce the litigation in reopening, a new scheme is introduced. But the tragedy is that the moment the new scheme is introduced and the notices are issued, today probably almost all the high courts are flooded with these writ petitions challenging the notices issued after 1st of April. And at the inception itself, if it is giving rise to so much of litigation, just in lighter way, I am commenting how far these two stated objectives are going to be achieved is anybody's guess. So now let us see what is the scheme for assessment of income escaping assessment, section 147. As it was reproduced in the earlier slide also, there is absence of the wording reason to believe. It only says if any income chargeable to tax in the case of an assessee has escaped assessment for any assessment year. So only requirement under the new regime is there. There should be income escaping assessment. The assessing officer may, subject to the provisions of section 148 to 153, assess or reassess such income or recompute the loss or depreciation allowance or any other allowance or deduction for such assessment year. And for the purpose of assessment or reassessment or recomputation, he may assess or reassess the income in respect of any issue which has escaped assessment, and such issue comes to his notice subsequently in the course of the proceeding under this section. Irrespective of the fact that the procedure as specified in section 148A has not been complied with respect to that other issue. To some extent, this is very much similar to the existing regime. Even in the existing regime, the AO records the reasons that based on such and such information, he has reasons to believe that income has escaped assessment. But if he records the reasons for an issue X and in the course of assessment, some other issue, say issue Y, comes to his knowledge, by virtue of explanation 3 in the existing regime, he can also assess such other income. Same provision has been continued even in the new regime. But the most important change is absence of the word reasons to believe. So the earlier law required that there should be reasons to believe. Those reasons should be recorded prior to issue of notice under 148. From that, there is a shift, and this section only requires that if any income chargeable to tax has escaped assessment. From the wording of section, it may give a wrong notion that this gives an unrestricted power to the assessing officer to reopen any kind of assessment, but that is not the case, as we'll see in the later slides, in the later requirement. And the most important of that is newly inserted section 148A. This section says that before issue of notice under section 148, there has to be some inquiry conducted, some opportunity to be provided to the SSC, etc., etc. So if we see the old regime, under the old regime, section 147 said that if the assessing officer has reasons to believe that some income has escaped assessment, he may assess such income or reassess such income. After 147, under the existing regime, there is section 148. That section says that, however, before this assessment, the assessing officer has to issue a notice requiring the assessee to file a return of income under section 148. And subsection 2 says that before issue of this notice, the assessing officer has to record the reasons. I will, in my later presentation, there is a comparative chart under the old regime and the new regime about the procedure for assessment. But just to explain this title of section 148A, whatever was there in the existing requirement of section 148, and as explained by the Supreme Court in the famous decision of GK and Dryshaf, and further explained by various high courts including our jurisdictional Bombay High Court, that settled procedure of assessment has probably been codified in the form of a section, and that is the section 148A. If we read the jurisprudence on the old reassessment sections, the only requirement under section 148 was issue of notice, and prior to issue of that notice, recording of the reasons. However, various high courts and the Supreme Court have further elaborated and explained that procedure of section 148, but those were judge-made law and not a codified or legislative law, in the sense that there was no specific section in the Income Tax Act which says that reasons will be furnished to the assessee, or the assessee can ask for the recorded reasons, or how that reason should be recorded by the assessing officer, what kind of application of mine he should do, etc., etc. Section was very silent on that. However, judiciary elaborated the requirement of application of mine on the information which is received by the assessee, and then recording of those reasons in a very clear term, and then only issuing notice under section 140. That judgment law probably has been codified in the form of this section 148A, which deals with conducting of inquiry, providing opportunity to the assessee before issue of notice under section 148. So what this section 148A says, there are four clauses in this newly inserted section, clause A, B, C, and D. The first one says that the assessing officer shall conduct an inquiry if required with the prior approval of specified authority concerning the information which suggests that income chargeable to tax has escaped assessment. Now, this is very important. The portion recorded in blue lines.
Devendra ji, you are on a mute, please.
Sir, I said kindly excuse me for 2 minutes. Sir, okay. I am very sorry. Just 2 minutes. My apologies. Shall we resume?
Yes, sir. Good.
So I was in this new section 148A, which says that AO shall conduct an inquiry if required with the prior approval of specified authority concerning the information which suggests that income chargeable to tax has escaped the assessment. Now, if we just recall what was there in section 147, the only requirement in section 147 was income escaping assessment. There was no mention of the word information. It only said that, if I may go back to the previous slide, just for a moment, the first paragraph in this slide, if any income chargeable to tax has escaped assessment, this is the requirement of section 147. After section 147, there is one more section 148, and thereafter this section 148A. For a reason I have skipped section 148, we'll see after 5 minutes what is there in section 148, the replaced or substituted section 148. But this requirement under section 148A, for the first time, some words are appearing in this clause A, information which suggests that income chargeable to tax has escaped assessment. So actually these wordings, information suggesting income chargeable to tax has escaped assessment, that we'll find in section 148, which we'll see 5 minutes later. But from what transpires here is that there has to be some information with the assessing officer, and that information to suggest that income chargeable to tax has escaped assessment. If the assessing officer has in his possession such information, what is supposed to do with that information? That is laid down in this clause A of section 148A, that he shall conduct an inquiry. And before conducting this inquiry, he has to take approval of specified authority. Which are those specified authority? That is given in section 151, which we'll see later. The only problematic thing in this particular clause, which otherwise is a very welcome clause, that even under the existing regime, whenever some information was received by the assessing officer, they used to start away record the reasons about satisfaction of income escaping assessment and reopening. And then in the High Court, we used to challenge such reasons that immediately after the receipt of information, without any application of mind by the assessing officer or without any further inquiry, he has directly reopened the assessment. And various High Courts have held that such a reopening is bad in law. Now, as I mentioned earlier also, all those judgment law has been now codified in the form of this specific section 148A, which says that the assessing officer shall conduct an inquiry concerning the information which suggests that income chargeable to tax has escaped assessment. That means there has to be, first of all, some information. Secondly, that information should suggest that income chargeable to tax has escaped assessment. If this twin requirement of existence of information and number two, suggesting that income chargeable to tax has escaped assessment, if these two twin requirements are satisfied, which are the foremost important prerequisite for reopening, then straight away assessing officer cannot proceed with reopening of assessment by issue of notice under section 148. Before that, he has to follow the mandatory procedure of section 148A. And subclause A that assessing officer shall conduct an inquiry. So it's a very welcome procedure laid down under the new regime. And the use of the word shall, the assessing officer shall conduct an inquiry. So it is mandatory for him to conduct an inquiry. The only problematic thing in these clauses, the use of the words if required. And in lighter way, it is funny also. At one stage, you say that the assessing officer shall conduct. That means it is mandatory for him to conduct an inquiry, and thereafter you qualify this with the words if required. So this leaves a lot of scope of subjectivity for the assessing officer to decide whether in a particular case he should conduct an inquiry or he should not conduct an inquiry. In any particular case where he doesn't conduct an inquiry, he may very well say that he felt that it is not required, and therefore he did not do it. I'm very sorry again. So, use of the words if required leaves a lot of discretion for the assessing officer whether he wants to conduct an inquiry or he doesn't want to conduct an inquiry. In the course of that inquiry, the next requirement under Clause B is granting an opportunity of being heard. The AO, with the prior approval of specified authority, shall provide an opportunity of being heard to the assessee by serving upon him a notice to show cause as to why notice under new section 148 should not be issued based on inquiry conducted or information which suggests that income chargeable to taxes escaped assessee. So, the first thing is existence of information. Secondly, that should suggest that income has escaped assessment. Thirdly, the assessing officer will have to conduct an inquiry and the results of the inquiry will have to be shared with the assessee by giving him an opportunity of being heard. Assessee can reply within a specified time. The specified time for this opportunity cannot be less than 7 days and maximum is 30 days, but subject to the discretion of the assessing officer. If assessee makes an application in that behalf, this time can be extended by the assessing officer. So minimum of 7 to 30 days, subject to also extension by assessing officer, this time is given for the assessee to represent that this is not a fit case for reopening, that this information or this result of an inquiry does not suggest that any income chargeable to taxes escaped assessment. In my understanding and in my humble view, this particular requirement of granting an opportunity being heard to the assessee is akin to assessee filing an objection against the recorded reasons in the existing regime. So under the existing regime, once a 148 is received, we file a return, then we seek the recorded reasons. It is mandatory for the assessing officer to share the recorded reasons. Then assessee may file his objections. In the same way, under the new regime, one inquiry will be conducted if required by the assessing officer and the result of the inquiry will be shared with the assessee or the information will be shared with the assessee and assessee can represent that this is not a fit case for reopening. What is funny in this is that normally when the show cause notice is issued, the show cause notice is for a proposed action. Like for example, show cause notice for penalty would say that according to us, such and such default has taken place. You are required to show cause as to why such penalty should not be imposed or levied upon you. Here the wordings are as such quite funny that this is a show cause notice as to why notice should not be issued. So prior to completion of your assessment, one notice is required to be issued under section 148 and under 148A, Clause B, there is a show cause as to why notice should not be issued under 148. But be that as it may be, it's a welcome step. Again, a codified law, mandatory for the assessing officer that he has to give his opportunity. Because here also the wordings used are shall provide an opportunity being heard to the assessee. And unlike in the previous clause, there is no discretion left to the assessing officer. Because Clause A says that assessing officer shall conduct an inquiry if required. However, Clause B does not say if required or any kind of discretion to the assessing officer, mandatory for the assessing officer that he shall provide an opportunity being heard to the assessee. Thereafter, Clause C, assessing officer shall consider the reply furnished by the assessee, if any, in response to the show cause notice issued by the assessing officer. And then finally, under Clause D, an order will be passed. Obviously, this is not an assessment order. This is just a preliminary order dealing with the objections which are filed by the assessee. So again, at the cost of repetition, I'll say the procedure under JK and Dryshep, recording of reasons, assessee filing written, then assessee asking for reasons, assessing officer giving him the reason, assessee filing objections against those reasons, and then assessing officer dealing with that objection by a speaking order has been codified in the form of this section 148A. And Clause D says that assessing officer shall decide based on the material available record, including reply furnished by the assessee, the result of the inquiry, etc., etc. What he has to decide is whether or not it is a fit case to issue a notice under new section 148.
And again, for this order, he has to take prior approval of authority specified under section 151. And it's a time-bound program. This order has to be passed within 1 month from the end of the month in which reply is received from the SSC. In case no reply is received from the SSC, the time limit to pass this order is within 1 month from the end of the month in which the time to furnish a reply to the SSC expires. Now, this order will be passed by the assessing officer under section 148A, clause D. This order is not an appealable order. And therefore, the only remedy for the SSC to challenge this order under clause D of section 148A is to file a writ petition before the High Court. Non-applicability of procedure under section 148A. Just now we have seen a four-step procedure under section 148A. Number one, conducting of an inquiry by the assessing officer. Number two, giving an opportunity to the assessee. Number three, considering the reply of the assessee. And number four, passing an order whether this will be a fit case for issue of notice under section 148. So here, the section further says that in certain situation, this procedure under section 148A will not be applicable. That means no inquiry, no opportunity to the assessee, no passing of a preliminary order, nothing will apply. What are those cases? Number one, search and requisition on or after 1st of April 2021. So as I said in the beginning, now there is no separate assessment procedure for search cases. And therefore, the moment a search takes place, it will be covered by new procedure of reassessment under section 147. And therefore, in search cases, there is no requirement for conducting a preliminary inquiry or giving opportunity to the assessee. The moment a search or requisition takes place on or after 1st April 21, the assessing officer can straight away proceed with issuing notice under section 148. Second situation, a survey is conducted under section 133A in the case of the assessee. Now, under the existing regime, in case of survey, there is no separate assessment procedure. However, as our experience suggests that in the course of survey, whatever information is gathered by the assessing officer, based on that, he may record his reasons that any income has escaped assessment for any assessment year, subject to the time limit available. And then generally he reopens assessment for those years for which he gathers some evidence in the course of survey under section 133A. Now it is statutorily given that in case of survey under section 133A, and in fact, as far as assessment is concerned, survey and search now have come to almost at par, subject to only few exceptions, which we'll see later. But otherwise, the procedure for assessment of survey cases and search cases has been aligned together along with reassessment, with a further requirement that procedure under 148A will not apply. Situation number C and situation number D, it is similar to the existing section 153C, where a search takes place in case of, say, Mr. X. However, in the course of search of Mr. X, either some assets belonging to Mr. Y are found or certain documents which pertain to Mr. Y are found, then under the existing regime, 153A notice was issued to the person searched under say, for example, Mr. X, and to the other person, that is Mr. Y, 153C notice used to be issued. Under the new regime, both the person searched, Mr. X, and the other person whose assets or documents are found in the course of that search, say, for example, Mr. Y, both these persons will be governed by the reassessment procedure under section 147. And in case of both these persons, the person searched as well as the other person, there is no requirement to follow the procedure under section 148A. So these are the four exceptions where 148A procedure is not to be followed. Very simple to remember is the only exception is survey and search cases. So the moment there is either a survey or a search, 148A procedure will not apply and directly reopening notice under 148 can be issued. Now we are back to the section 148, issue of notice where income has escaped assessment. This section is already there in the statute. However, with effect from 1st of April 21, this section is substituted by a new section. What does the new section say? Before making any assessment or reassessment, a notice is required to be served under section 148. along with, this is very important, a copy of the order passed under clause D of section 148A, requiring the assessee to furnish return of his income or the income of any other person in respect of which he is assessable under this act during the previous year corresponding to relevant assessment year. So some part of it is very much similar to the existing 148, that it will, a notice will be issued requiring the assessee to furnish return of income. So here also, before making an assessment, a notice will be issued requiring the assessee to furnish return of income. The new thing is that along with this notice, a copy of the order passed under section 148A clause B will have to be served along with this notice. That means 148A is a stage prior to section 148. And in the later part of my presentation, in fact, I made a flowchart of the entire new assessment regime. But from the discussion which we just now had, what we can infer is assessing officer will conduct an inquiry, give opportunity to the assessee. Assessee will furnish his reply. He will consider that reply and pass an order that it is a fit case for issue of notice under 148. This order needs to be attached along with the notice under section 148. However, as we have already seen, that there are four exceptional cases where section 148A doesn't apply. Those four cases, in summary, and we can say search and survey cases where 148A doesn't apply. In those cases, directly a 148 notice can be issued and there is no requirement to serve the order under section 148A because that section itself doesn't apply to such situations. Now, this notice under section 148 can be issued only when there is information with the assessing officer which suggests that the income chargeable to tax has escaped assessment. So the earlier section 148 prior to amendment says that assessing officer had reasons to believe and before issue of notice under 148, he has to record those reasons. The new section does not use the word reasons to believe. It says that this notice can be issued only when there is information with the assessing officer. And secondly, that information should suggest that income chargeable to tax has escaped assessment. Then prior approval of specified authority is required to be obtained before issue of this notice under section 148. So the next immediate question is what constitutes information? Now, if we read the existing jurisprudence on reopening, in fact, in the existing reopening law, various sections dealing with reopening, the word information itself is absent. Nowhere the section talks about any information. It is only from the judge-made law. Various decisions of Supreme Court like Calvinator and so many other judgments where there has been a thrust on existence of tangible material or a fresh information which can lead to recording of reason by the assessing officer that income has escaped assessment. These various decisions giving various attributes of information may not be applicable in the new regime, because under the new regime, this word information has been exhaustively defined. So what is the definition? First of all, the second heading is very important in cases other than search, survey, or requisition. So explanation 1 to section 148 defines information, but this section does not apply again in survey and search cases. There are two kinds of information defined in this particular explanation. Information suggesting that income chargeable to tax has escaped assessment means. So very important is to note the word means. Because of the word means, this is an exhaustive definition of information. No other thing on earth can constitute an information. Only these two things can constitute an information for the purpose of issuing notice under section 148. What are those two things? Number one, any information flagged in the case of the assessee for the relevant assessment year as per the risk management strategy formulated by the CBDT from time to time. So information means information flagged in the case of the assessee. So directly, actually speaking, they have not defined the word information, but they have given only this from attributes or parameters. As to what could be information, information will be only that which is flagged in the case of the assessee for the relevant AY as per the risk management strategy formulated by CBDT. Now, what is this risk management strategy formulated by CBDT? from time to time. Obviously, it is not in public domain, but from the explanatory memorandum, we can get some clue as to what is this risk management strategy. Also, from time to time, various press releases are issued and various statements are by finance ministry. And now we are using artificial intelligence in tax assessment for gathering of information. And even the explanatory memorandum to current finance act suggests that we are gathering information from law enforcement agencies, from the statement of financial transaction under section 285 SB, etc. So based on that, only an information which is flagged in the case of the SSE. So it cannot be what we can infer. Most important part which we can infer from this is that this information cannot be anything coming from any particular source, and then based on his subjective approach, no discretion on the assessing officer that whether he has to use this thing as an information or not. Based on the artificial intelligence and use of technology, the moment there is receipt of some information from an external source, it will be flagged in the case of the SSE. That means in the ITBA portal, which the assessing officers have access, automatically that information will appear. What the assessing officer is required to do is only has to conduct the procedure under section 148A, that based on this information, he has to do an inquiry and pass an order under section 148A. So based on that risk management strategy, information will be automatically flagged using technology in the SSE's portal. Am I audible?
Yes, audible.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir, audible. Second kind of information, final objection raised by the C&AG to the effect that the assessment in the case of an SSE has not been made as per the provisions of the Income Tax Act. So as you are aware that currently also, all the assessment orders are subjected to departmental audit, and many times notices are issued based on the observation given by the audit party. In fact, in the context of the earlier regime where this word information was not at all used under the various sections of reopening, but used in the various decisions of High Court and Supreme Court. And on various occasions, High Court and Supreme Court had dealt with whether audit objection will constitute an information and whether it can lead to reopening. So various High Court and Supreme Court decisions have said that audit objection does not constitute an information and no reopening can be based solely on audit objection. These judgments, in my humble view, will not hold good in the new region. For the simple reason that now information has been statutorily defined in explanation 1 to section 148. And there are only two limbs in that definition. Number one, anything flagged in your case based on the risk management strategy formulated by CBDT. And secondly, objection done by C&AG that assessment in particular case has not been done as per the provisions of the Income Tax Act. So these two things will constitute an information. I can see few questions. Most of them actually are going to be covered in my later part of the discussion. So let me go ahead a little bit. Thereafter, I will deal with these questions.
Yeah, that's perfect, sir.
Deemed information suggesting income has escaped assessment. Probably, no part of our Income Tax Act gets a solvation or satisfaction till they insert certain deeming fiction in this. So just now we have seen that under section 148, a notice is to be issued to the SSE. Along with that notice, the order under 148A is to be served to the SSE. And that notice can be issued only when there is an information which is suggesting income is escaped assessment. Now, explanation 2 says that in search, survey, requisition cases, there is a deeming fiction that assessing officer has the information. If I just go back to the previous slide, where the second title,
that is explanation one applies in cases other than search, survey or requisition. So these two kinds of information based on risk management strategy, information flagged in your account, and secondly, audit objection by CNH. These two are the information which are required in normal cases. However, in search and survey cases, there is a deeming fiction for 3 years. Search or survey conducted on or after 1st of April 21, it shall be deemed that assessing officer has information which suggests that income chargeable to tax has escaped assessment in the case of the assessee for 3 assessment years immediately preceding the assessment year relevant to the previous year in the following cases. In the following cases are 4 cases. Number one, search on or after 1st April 21, search or requisition. Number two, survey under section 133A. And number three and number four, the other persons under the existing regime, what we have 153C. So these 4 cases we already seen in the context of section 148A, that in these 4 cases, the entire procedure of 148A does not apply. Same 4 cases, explanation 2 to section 148 says that in these 4 cases, for the last 3 years, it is automatically presumed that the assessing officer has got information which suggests that income has escaped assessment, and therefore he can straight away issue notice under section 148. So if we compare this with section 153A, currently what used to take place, suppose today is 12th of July 2021. So suppose a search takes place today. In the earlier regime, what would have happened? We are in financial year 21-22, a search takes place. So you omit this 21-22, the preceding 6 financial year ending up to financial year 2021. Those preceding 6 years were covered by section 153A in the case of search person and under section 153C in case of other person. So 6 years notices would be issued under section 153A under the existing regime. But now they are saying, because now 153A, 153C does not apply in case of searches after on or after 1st April 21. They say we'll do reopening of your assessment under section 147. For that, we'll issue notice under section 148. And in normal situation, 148 requires existence of information. However, the moment a search has taken place for the last 3 years, there is no further requirement that there should be any information suggesting escapement of income, and automatically last 3 years assessment will be reopened under section 147. So what they used to do for 6 years, they are now doing for only last 3 years. That doesn't mean other beyond 3 years preceding, those will be immune. There is a separate regime for that also. But for these 3 years, there is a deeming fiction that there is information, and automatically 148 can be issued. What is very important is the change in case of survey. If you compare the existing section 133A, the moment a survey takes place, there is no separate assessment regime, and therefore, if for any preceding year, assessment is to be reopened under 147, under the existing regime, that would have required recording of reason based on tangible material. So only in case of survey, if anything is revealed for a particular year, then only that particular year's assessment could have been reopened in the existing regime. However, the new regime says that if today's survey takes place on 12th of July 21, then the last three financial year 2021, financial year 1920, and financial year 1819, these 3 years, automatically 148 notice will be issued. There is no further requirement that there should be information suggesting escapement of income. So the moment a search or survey takes place, automatically last 3 years assessment would be subjected to an assessment under the new regime. So what we are noticing here is the earlier regime required reasons to believe. Now what is required is that there should be information suggesting escapement. In so many decisions of Supreme Court, starting from the very old decision of 103 ITR in Lakmani Mewal Das, to the recent decisions of Supreme Court in Asset Reconstruction Company in 424 ITR, they have dealt with this live link theory. that there has to be a nexus or live link between reasons recorded and the formation of belief to come to a conclusion that income chargeable to tax has escaped assessment. Even though this phrase reason to believe is removed and replaced by the word information suggesting escapement, in my view, even this would be requiring a live link between the information in the possession of the assessee, of the assessing officer, and his final conclusion that it is suggesting some income has escaped assessment. So only the wordings are changing, but in substance, the law remains the same. Time limit for notice under section 149. Under the existing law, as we are all aware, the normal time limit is 4 years, and beyond 4 years, it can go up to maximum 6 years, provided income escaping assessment is more than 1 lakh, and where the escaped income relates to any foreign transaction, income outside India, the maximum reopening period is 16 years. Now they say, in general scenario, the time limit for issuance of notice is only 3 years. No notice shall be issued if 3 years have elapsed from the end of the relevant assessment year. Beyond 3 years, what will happen? Where the assessing officer has evidence in his possession, which reveals that the income escaping assessment represented in the form of asset amounts to or is likely to amount to rupees 50 lakh or more, then notice can be issued beyond a period of 3 years, but not beyond the period of 10 years from the end of the relevant assessment year. So the maximum time period for reopening is increased to 10 years. However, there are certain caveats for this extended time limit of 10 years. The general time limit for reopening, which under the existing law was 6 years, is reduced to 3 years. Though there was a cap of 1 lakh rupees, but generally in all cases, if they have got some information about escapement of income, it used to be more than 1 lakh rupees. So generally, we used to think that maximum time for reopening is 6 years. That 6 year is reduced to 3 years in general scenario. However, there is also an increase. Though the explanatory memorandum says that we have reduced the period of reopening to reduce the litigation. But just see what section 149 says. It says in general, the reopening is for 3 years. However, it can go up to 10 years, provided certain conditions are fulfilled. And what are those conditions? For this extended period of 10 years, there are three conditions to be fulfilled. Number one, income escaping assessment is represented in the form of asset. And they have defined the word asset to include immovable property, being land or building or both, shares and securities, loans and advances, deposits in bank account. This is the definition of asset. So the first condition, income escaping assessment should be represented in the form of asset. Second condition, the amount of income escaping assessment is likely to amount to rupees 50 lakh or more. And third and most important, the assessing officer has evidence in his possession to suggest that these two conditions are fulfilled. At the cost of repetition, I'll say again, first condition, the income escaping assessment is represented in the form of asset. Second condition, the amount is more than 50 lakh rupees. And third and fourth, most important, the assessing officer has evidence in his possession, which reveals that these two conditions, that is income represented by asset and amount more than 50 lakh. Now, the earlier part of earlier section, they've used the word information, but here they've used the word evidence. So it is not merely sufficient for the assessing officer to have some information, but he should have a concrete evidence. Then he can reopen for maximum 10 years. So for example, if we take a case of a search, what will happen in case of a search case? Normally in case of search cases under the existing regime, 6 year notices are issued under 153 or 153C. Under the new regime, they say, first of all, notices can be immediately issued under section 148 for the past 3 years. And for those past 3 years, no requirement of existence of information. In case of search cases, automatically those 3 years, and same applies even in case of survey. However, beyond 3 years, whether it is a case of a search, whether it is a case of a survey, or it is any general case, irrespective of a further classification between search, survey, or in any general case, if these three conditions are fulfilled, assessing officer has got evidence to suggest that there is some asset which has been concealed by the assessee. So income escaping assessment is represented in the form of asset and the amount is more than 50 lakhs, then reopening can go up to 10 years. Now, because the earlier regime, maximum reopening was for 6 years, and under the new regime, maximum reopening is for 10 years. There is a saving clause which says that notice under the new section 148 cannot be issued if at the time of issue of that notice, this notice was already time barred under the existing law. For example, a very important point. We all are aware, prior to the COVID pandemic had affected the country, that is March 2020. Assessment year 12-13, 6 year period was already expired in March 19. But when this first lockdown was announced in the month of March 2020, assessment year 13-14, 6 years time limit was expiring on 31st of March 2020. Which has been extended by the Taxation Amendment Act and certain notification, which we'll see in the later part. But just take a case of 13-14. The last date for 13-14 without the Taxation Amendment Act was March 20. Even after the COVID extension, the last date was 30th of June 2020. Take another year, say 14-15. 14-15, 6 years reopening was on March 21. Even with the extension of COVID Act, Relaxation Act, it was June 20. So suppose today, 12th of July 2021, some assessing officer says that I have evidence in my possession that more than 50 lakh rupees of escaped income represented in the form of asset pertaining to assessment year 13-14 or say assessment year 12-13 is found. So suppose today, 12th of July 2021, somebody issues notice for 12-30 saying that these three conditions are fulfilled. Now the extended period is 10 years from the end of the assessment year. If you count 12-13, say 10 years, it will go up to 31st of March 23. For 13-14, March 24. For 14-15, March 25 and so on. However, when this Finance Act came into picture on 1st of April 2021. These notices are already time barred and therefore this particular provision in section 149 saves the time limit, gives a saving clause to the assessee that the assessment where notice could not be issued under the old regime prior to amendment by the current Finance Act will not be covered by the new regime. But take a case of assessment year 15-16. Under the old regime, 15-16, 6 years period would have expired on 31st of March 2022. That means even today, on 12th of July 2021, reopening notice could have been issued for 15-16 under the old law. And therefore, even under the new law, if the assessing officer wants to issue notice under the extended period up to 10 years, he can do so for assessment year 15-16. That will not be saved under this particular clause. But till assessment year 14-15, which have already expired prior to the commencement of Finance Act 21, these are saved that those will not be reopened under this extended time limit of 10 years. Next section, sanction for issue of notice under the existing regime. If the reopening is up to 4 years, sanction is to be taken from Joint Commissioner. Beyond 4 years, sanction is to be taken from principal commissioner. Now, this section is replaced with a new section which says that up to 3 years, mandatory sanction is to be taken for principal commissioner or principal director or commissioner or director. But beyond 3 years, approval is to be taken from principal chief commissioner or principal director general. So, high level of sanction is required. And this sanction is not only for the purpose of issuing a notice under 148, but also for the purpose of conduct of inquiry under newly inserted section 148A. So earlier, for 4 years, Joint Commissioner sanction, up to 6 years, PCIT sanction. Now, for 3 years, it is PCIT sanction. Beyond 3 years, up to 10 years, sanction is to be taken for principal CCIT. And because whenever a sanction is required, there are so many decisions of various decisions of Supreme Court as well as High Court, that the sanction has to be by way of application of mind. It cannot be a mechanical sanction, that you cannot just put a rubber stamp on whatever information is, whatever record is maintained by the assessing officer. The sanctioning authority is also to independently examine and frame an opinion whether it's a fit case for giving an approval for reopening of the case. So all those jurisprudence will still be applicable under the new section 150, substituted section 151. In between the COVID pandemic year, when this Taxation Relaxation Act was introduced, there was one section 151A introduced dealing with faceless assessment. So this is not an amendment by Finance Act 21. This section 151A has been inserted by the Taxation Relaxation Act. And it is similar to section 144B, which we have for the normal faceless assessment regime. In the same way, for the faceless reassessment, so all the reassessment will be done in a faceless manner, and CBDT will come out with the scheme for that reassessment. And for that scheme, this is just a section giving power to the central government to notify that particular faceless reassessment scheme. Time limit for completion of assessment, 12 months from the end of the financial year in which 148 notice is served, where a reference is made to the TPO, then extended further by 12 months. So 24 months in case reference to DPO, normal scenario, 12 months from the end of the month in which, from the end of the year in which 148 is served on the assessment. So with this, if I may summarize the new reassessment and search assessment procedure. First of all, I made two slides. This slide deals with non-search cases. So in non-search cases, what is the first step required is there should be some information to suggest that income has escaped. Next step, inquiry to be done by the assessing officer under section 148A clause A, opportunity to be given to the assessee under clause B, reply of assessee to be considered under clause C, and then an order to be passed under clause D that it is a fit case for issue of notice under 140. After this, issue of notice under 148 along with 148AD order, this return of income will be treated as if it were a return required to be filed under section 139, and therefore a scrutiny notice under section 143(2) will have to be issued for that, and then complete the assessment of that escaped income and also any other income which comes to the notice in the course of assessment. In case of search cases, as we already noted, because 148A does not apply, and therefore the requirement is that for 3 years, for preceding 3 years, existence of information is not required. Beyond 3 years, up to 10 years, information is needed. In fact, not information, evidence would be needed. Then issue notice under 148 to file return of income, and thereafter the procedure is same. So the only difference between search and non-search cases, that in case of non-search cases, information to suggest that income has escaped, and then the entire procedure of 148A to be done. In case of search cases, information not required for first 3 years, beyond 3 years, evidence is needed. However, in both cases, first 3 years or beyond 3 years, in case of search cases as well as survey cases, 148A procedure is not required. This is a brief comparison. Old procedure, AO had reason to believe that income has escaped assessment, then he has to record the reasons. Under the new procedure, AO has information which suggests that income has escaped assessment, and then he has to follow procedure under section 148A. The time limit under the old regime was up to 6 years. In case of foreign income or asset involved, 16 years. That has been now changed to 3 years and 10 years. Sanction, first 4 years JCIT, beyond that, PCCIT or PCIT. Now, up to 3 years, it is PCIT. Beyond 3 years, PCCIT. This was the procedure laid down under the in the Supreme Court decision of GK and Dryshef, that the moment notice under 148 is issued, first step for the SSD is to file the written. This entire procedure of one GK and Dryshef, you can compare it with the new section 148A with a very important change, that under the old regime, the moment 148 was issued, you have to file the written. After filing the written, you can ask for the reasons. AO is bound to furnish the reason within a reasonable time. On receipt of reason, SSE may file the objection. If SSE files the objection, AO is bound to dispose the objection with a speaking order. And where the SSE is not satisfied with this order rejecting the objection, he can file a writ in the High Court challenging the reopening procedure. This has been codified in the form of 148A. With a very important change, what 148 says that, first of all, whatever information the assessing officer has got, he has to do an inquiry and he has to share the result of that inquiry or that information with the assessee. Then the assessee has to file his objection. Thereafter, the assessee has to file, assessing officer has to pass an order under 148AD. After passing that order, he will issue notice under 148 and thereafter assessee will be filing written of income. So what very important changes under the existing regime, the moment 148 is received, you have to first file the reason, file the written, thereafter ask for the reasons. Whereas under the new regime, before issue of 148 itself, there will be preliminary notice under 148A, information will be shared, you file your objections and an order will be passed and thereafter 148 will be issued and then you file the written. Before going forward, certain issues which I have raised, I will see there are certain questions in the chat box.
Should I read it out, sir?
No, I am reading it.
Okay.
Sure, Bhavari sir, I asked a question whether the proposition of no incriminating material is available if 132 is read with new provision, the way Bombay High Court did in continental warehousing. I believe this is actually a very contentious issue. But my preliminary view on this case is that for the 3 years reopening, the theory of incriminating material would not be needed. Beyond 3 years, of course, statutorily now it is required that there has to be an evidence in the possession of the assessing officer. So I believe for the first 3 years, this continental theory may not apply, but beyond 3 years, of course, it will apply. And it will more strongly apply because the law itself requires that this needs to be done. Second question is about legal error not able to submit response to notice under 148. Any solution available online or have to visit departmental office? I believe this problem was actually there in also in the old portal. So I don't know whether this question is the new portal specific, then I don't have an answer. But if it is related to this portal, what is the procedure required is that in the e-filing account, the legal error has to be first added. And once that legal error is added and approved, then automatically in the legal errors login, two options used to appear, whether that it is for yourself or as a legal heir. Then when you click as a legal heir, I believe those notices or proceeding of that person, deceased person will appear. And in response to that, you can submit the return. Can SSE ask details of what information AO had relayed before issuing such notice? Within what period AO is law bound to give such details? Of course, if it is under the new provision, then it is statutorily required that he has to give us an opportunity under section 148A, clause B. And of course, that opportunity will be an empty formality if he doesn't share the information which he has got. Because otherwise, unless you give me on what basis you are going to reopen my assessment, on what basis am I supposed to respond? So naturally, we'll have to share that information. If he doesn't share the information, it will be an empty formality and it will not be a fair opportunity. Are notices issued? Next question. Are notices issued after 1st of April 21 covered by the new section 148, read with section 148A, or are they covered by old section 148? Many notices received, code reasons to believe. What should be the way forward in case of these notices? The second part of my lecture is entirely on
what should be done about these notices. So it will be covered in my further discussion. Whether one needs to file written again in response to notice under section 148, of course, that is the mandatory requirement. The moment you receive under notice under 148, you have to submit your return of income. If notice under 148 for AY 1415 was issued on 30th of June with the code reasons to believe without giving the show cause, would it be a valid notice? This again also will be covered in the presentation. So let's move back to the presentation. All these issues along with them, certain other issues I have on my own highlighted. If thereafter further other issues, we'll also take up those issues. So this is some background material for the issues which I'm going to highlight and the controversies which are right now prevailing before the Honorable Bombay High Court and other High Court. What is the background? Due date for issuing notice under 148 for assessment year 1314 and 1415. So as everybody is aware that earlier law required that maximum reopening was 6 years, then let us assume that this was a case where the income escaping assessment was more than 1 lakh and therefore the maximum reopening period was 6 years. So 1314, 6 years would have ended on 31st of March 2020. And from 15th of March 2020, our life had started to come to an halt. I believe on 22nd or 23rd of March, there was some Janta curfew and thereafter that lockdown was announced. So tackle this situation, on 31st of March 2020, one ordinance was issued by the President of India, which ordinance was later replaced by a full-fledged Parliamentary Act, the Taxation and Other Laws Relaxation of Certain Provisions Act 2020. In brief, we'll call as a TLA 2020. Under the TLA 2020, as originally enacted, that given various relaxations to the assessee as well as to the department. We are currently concerned with the issue of notice under 148. So we'll restrict the discussion of TLA to 148 part. The TLA as originally enacted said that any compliance which the assessee was required to do, or forget about assessee, any notices which the department had to issue or any order which the department had to pass, if the due date for that action fell between 20th of March 2020 to 31st of December 2020, these were extended to 31st of March 2021. So it's very confusing. So kindly pay attention and kindly see, I am reading the first paragraph. Compliance falling between 20th March 2020 to 31st of December 2020. This was extended to 31st of March 2021. So let us take a case of assessment year 1314. 148 notice should have been issued by, say, 31st of March 2020. Now, because 31st March 2020 falls between 20th of March and 31st of December, by way of TLA, the time limit for issue of this 148 notice was extended to 31st March 2021. In my humble view, this TLA first paragraph will not apply to assessment year 1415, because for assessment year 1415, 6 years time period would be falling due on 31st of March 2021. What TLA extended is only compliance which was to be done between 20th of March and 31st December. Because 1415 is to be getting time out on March 21, the first paragraph did not apply. Thereafter, a subsequent development, notification number 93 dated 31st of December, there they said due date, if it is falling between 20th of March 2020 to 30th of March 2021. This is extended to 31st March 21. So TLA said that if due date is expiring on till 31st December, if you see the first part, second part of the first paragraph, there is a window. If your compliance is falling between 20th of March to 31st December, extended to 31st March, notification number 93 says that if your compliance is falling between 20th of March to 30th of March, 30 March, then date is extended to 31st March. In my view, even this notification number 93 does not apply to 1415, because 1415 148 notice was getting time barred on 31st of March 21 and not 30th of March 21. Thereafter, a new notification number 20, which is dated 31st of March 21, they said that if your due date is falling between 20th of March 20 to 31st of March 21, then it is extended up to 30th of April 21. So if you compare notification number 93 with notification number 20, notification number 93 only extended the actions which were getting due on 30th March, whereas notification number 20 said if something fell due on 31st March 21, that is also extended. So that extension came till 30th of April. So this will, notification number 20 will cover the notice for assessment year 14-15. The controversy about the Finance Act 21 getting enacted, the new notification coming into picture, we'll see little later. But just stick to understanding of this background material that if I take assessment year 14-15, 6 years time limit getting expired on 31st of March 21, and therefore notification number 20 dated 31st of March extended the time limit up to 30th of April. Similarly, another notification number 38 dated 27th of April, it said that if due date is getting expired on 30th of April 21, that is extended till 30th of June 21. Now that is the last extension. If we take all these extensions together, read with the Taxation Relaxation Act, TLA 2020, the summary is that any notice which the department was to issue between 20th of March 2020 to 30th of April 2021, I'll again repeat the dates, any notice which was to be issued between 20th of March 2020 to 30th of April 2021 could be issued till 30th of June 2021. So even assessment year 13-14 and 14-15 notices, by virtue of the Taxation Relaxation Act TLA 2020, read with notification number 20 dated 31st of March 21, read with notification number 38 dated 27th of April 21, the final extension is till 30th of June 2021. Now, what with this background, the question is which law shall apply to the notices issued after 31st of March 21? And why this question arises is all the amendments which we have just seen in this last 1.5 hour, amendment by Finance Act 21. Substituted section 147, 148, 149, and 151. These four sections are substituted with effect from 1st of April 21. However, and again going back to the previous slide, notification number 20, dated 31st of March 21, that had extended the due date till 30th of April 21. And further extended to 30th of June by notification number 30. So if by virtue of this notification number 20 and notification number 38, any notice is issued up to 30th of June, that may be valid as far as that notification is concerned. However, suppose that notice is issued on 1st of April 21 or any period between April, May and June as per those notification, on the date of issuing those notices, that particular section itself is no longer in the statute. Because Finance Act 21 has substituted the section 148, 147, 148, 149, and 151 with effect from 1st of April 20. Therefore, to cover this situation, what legislature has done is that in the notification number 20 of 2021, and also notification number 38, the last two notification, which had extended it beyond 31st of March 21. Notification number 20 extended to 30th of April. Notification number 38 extended to 30th of June. In these two notification, along with this extension, central government has also inserted an explanation. It states that for the purpose of issuance of notice under section 148, the provisions of unamended 148, 149, and 151 shall apply. I pause it, pause here for 10 seconds to digest as to what this means. See, all these notifications, they are only for the purpose of extending the due date. But when this extension was to go beyond 31st of March 2021, when the earlier section is no longer in force and a substitute section has been enacted by the parliament by an executive direction, the notification says that for the purpose of issuance of notice under section 148, the unamended 148, 149 and 151 will apply. And that's the root cause of controversy. And that is the subject matter of litigation before the Honorable Jurisdictional High Court and other High Court. That when the TLA delegates to the central government the limited power to specify the extension of due dates, can a notification issued by delegated legislation authorized to notify the due date, can it lay down a new procedural law also along with notifying the extended date? Because the TLA, which has been enacted by the Act of Parliament, TLA has delegated the power to issue this notification to central government to extend the due dates. So that is fine. You have extended the due date from time to time. Earlier it was December. You extended it to 30th of March. You again extended it to 31st March for compliances falling due on 31st of March. But now when you are extending it beyond 31st March 21, you are saying, no, for this, the section which is today or the date of issue of notice under 148, whatever is the law, that will not apply. But a law which today is not into force, which was once upon a time was in force, will issue notice under that law which doesn't exist as on today. This cannot be done, in my humble view. This cannot be done by way of a notification. If that thing was required to be done, it required an intervention of the legislature, that is the parliament. When the finance bill is introduced in the parliament, it is passed by both the houses and presidential assent is received. Finance Bill 21 became Finance Act 2021 on 28th of March 2021. That law of parliament has substituted this section, and with that substitution, the earlier section is no longer on statute on 1st of April 21. And therefore, if at all notice is to be issued, it has to be issued under the new law. And the new law will require that before 148, you have to follow the mandatory procedure of section 148A. If that has not been done and the notice is issued under the old law, the first thing, old law is not on statute book on the date of issue of this notice. And secondly, the alleged explanation, the impugned explanation in the notification, where they are saying that the unamended provision of 148, 149, 151 will apply. In my humble view, that is ultra virus, the taxation, the relaxation at 2020. Because TLA had only delegated the power to specify the extension of due dates. With this extension of due date under an executive notification, they had no power to specify that a non-existing law will apply to these notices. So controversy doesn't end here. There is so much to discuss further also.
Devendra sir?
Devendra sir got disconnected or what?
Members, some technical glitch. Please wait for 2 minutes. Devendra sir? Members, please wait for some emergency. Deven sir is resuming in 2 minutes.
Nilesh sir, I am not able to share and I am not able to start my video.
1 minute. Saraj sir?
Then just check sir.
Yeah, tell me.
Yeah, Dipen has already given the right sir. Now we can try.
Okay. Is it visible?
Yes sir.
Yes sir. Go ahead.
I forgot to attach the charger. I went out of battery.
We were about to issue 148 notice to you, sir. But you are again.
I would have challenged it. Anyway, so the first issue which I was saying is that the explanation inserted in the notification, which says that the unamended law will apply to the notices issued after 1st of April 21. That explanation is ultra vires for two reasons. Number one, by way of an executive instruction, you cannot say that a non-existing law will be still applicable. When a law has already been substituted, you cannot bring it into existence just by way of issuing a notification. That is not sanctioned by our constitutional setup. Second reason, issuing notification is a delegated form of legislation, and a delegated legislation derives its power from the parent act. In this case, the parent act is TLA 2021, which is only given the power to notify the extension of due dates. Putting further caveat that under these extended due dates, when notices are issued, unamended law will be applicable. That power of delegation, that power was not with the central government, and therefore that particular explanation in the notification is ultra. Second issue, as I discussed earlier also, when TLA had extended this due date, they came out with a window. They're saying if the due date was falling between this date and this date, it will be extended to this. So that window, which was initially from 20th of March 2020 to 31st of December 2020, this window was later on enlarged. And the last window enlarging was for the compliances which were to expire by 30th of June 2021. So if you take the case of assessment year 15-16, the 6 year period was to end on March 22. So in any case, that was not getting time barred either on 31st March 21 or 30th of June 21. So all the notices under from assessment year 15-16 onwards, in any case, even section 3 of the statute did not apply to them. So if the notice is issued for assessment year 13-14 or say 14-15, the department trying to take shelter of that explanation in the extension notification, but as we discussed earlier, that notification itself is under a challenge. But secondly, if it is applicable for 15-16 to 16-17, forget about the notification. In my view, the TLA itself does not apply to assessment year 15-16 or 16-17, because that was in any case not getting time barred in that particular window. Another issue is about the constitutional validity of the TLA itself. What TLA has delegated is power to the central government to extend the time limit for various things, and including issuing a notice under 148. However, there is no maximum time limit kept or a sunset clause kept in that notification. From time to time, as we have already seen earlier, there was a notification number 93 on 31st December, then a subsequent notification number 20 on 31st March 21, then notification number 38 on 27th of April 21, and so on and so forth. But there is no maximum time limit that to what date maximum they can extend. That sunset is not provided under TLA. That means that an unfettered or an unreasonable arbitrary power is given to the central government that they can issue a notification and go on increasing the time limit infinitely. In fact, technically speaking, under the TLA 2020, they can issue and keep on extending notification and extend the due date for issuing, say, assessment year 13-14, 148 notices till, say, 31st of March 2030 also, because there is no maximum time limit kept. And so, okay, you can extend it today, but till what date can you extend? And therefore, on the touchstone of Article 14 and Article 265, the constitutional validity of Section 3 of Section TLA itself has been challenged. All these issues have been recently considered by the Jurisdictional High Court. And there is one more aspect. So, there, from 1st of April 2021, Section 148A is into place. And this is very interesting. Our first argument is that after 1st of April 21, notice could not be issued under the old law. It has to be issued under the new law, because old law is no longer into statute on or after 1st of April 21. However, if you see all the notices issued right now under Section 148, they use the expression reason to believe, which is not there under the new Section 148. And therefore, it appears that they are issuing it under the old law, and that is our first argument, that now you cannot issue notice under the old law. The second argument, even if the notice is to be issued under the new law, you have to mandatorily follow the procedure under Section 148A. Prior to issue of notice under Section 148. And going further, even assuming for a moment that that particular explanation under that notification is a valid explanation, and therefore they had the power even to notify that which sections will apply, what that notification only says that unamended 148, 149 and 151 will apply. So assuming for a moment that that particular explanation is valid, still that notification does not stop 148A from being operative. So even if you issue 148 notice under the old law, still you have to follow 148A, which has been operational from 1st of April 2021. And once it has been operational on 1st of April 2021, if you read 148A, it says categorically, before the issue of notice under 148, you have to follow this procedure. So forget about the controversy of whether 148 is under the old law or under the new law. Under both the regime, if a notice is issued after 1st of April 21, you have to mandatorily follow 148A. In so many decisions of Supreme Court, including this one highlighted here, Canon India Private Limited, Supreme Court has time and again said that if a statute requires a thing to be done in a particular manner, it has to be done in that particular manner and nothing else is permitted. And therefore, after 1st of April 21, 148A is there on the statute. So even if you are issuing notice under the old 148, after 1st of April 21, that should have been done after following the mandatory procedure under 148A. This is a recent decision of jurisdictional High Court in Sahil International, where they have entered interim stay to the notice under section 148. This was for assessment year 15-16. Department is yet to file the reply. Another interesting issue, what will be the due date for assessment year 15-16 to 17-18? As I discussed earlier, in my view, TLA applied only for those cases where the due date was to expire till 31st of March 2021. 15-16, 6 years ending on March 22. 16-17, March 23. 17-18, March 24. And therefore, TLA doesn't apply. In any case, from 1st of April 21, 148 has been substituted, and therefore, all notices which are to be issued after 1st of April 21 has to be under the new. Now, under the new law, the reopening is can be done only for maximum 3 years, unless, of course, you find in that exceptional situation, escaped income represented by asset amount more than 50 lakhs, and assessing officer having evidence in his possession to suggest this. So for a moment, let us assume that these three conditions are not fulfilled. So in normal scenario, the time limit is 3 years, and therefore 15-16 to 17-18, this 3 years time limit has already expired and no notice can be issued under the new law for these assessment year. Under the new law for these assessment year, notice can be issued only if you fulfill the conditions given in section 149, 1B of 50 lakh and escaped income represented by asset. Carve-outs from the former provision, also two very important things. If you see the old 147, there were various provisos in section 147 which do not find place in the new section 147. First proviso to section 147 said that if already a regular assessment has taken place, then beyond 4 years, reopening cannot be done unless there is a failure on the part of the assessee to disclose fully and truly all material facts relevant for that year. So on factual aspects, if an already scrutinized case is there beyond 4 years, reopening could not be done unless there is a failure on the part of the assessor. And on this basis, various notices have been quashed under the old regime. Now under the new section 147, this particular requirement of full and true disclosure in already scrutinized cases is not there. And therefore, this theory of full and true disclosure will not apply for the new assessment regime. Secondly, there was a third proviso. We spoke about the doctrine of partial merger. And suppose in your case, a section 143 assessment has already taken place. And in that particular issue, you have filed an appeal to the commissioner and thereafter to the tribunal, etc., etc. So the matters which are subject matter of appeal, on those matters, no new reopening notice could be issued under the old law. That was the requirement of the third proviso. So even if the assessing officer gets certain new information about that very issue, which is already decided, which is subject matter of appeal, reference or revision, then he can give that material to that appellate authority. And that appellate authority will see what cognizance is to be taken of that material as per law. But on the same issue, which is subject matter of appeal to the higher authority, the assessing officer cannot issue a new 148 notice. This was the requirement of third proviso, and even that is absent in the new section 147. And in the absence of a statutory, this will lead to a fresh take of litigation that under the hierarchical system of adjudication, if my matter is pending before commissioner appeal or tribunal, can on the same issue, assessing officer again issue notice under section 147. Earlier law, there is a specific bar under third proviso. New law is silent as to this aspect. So this will give rise to a fresh of litigation. This was a presentation from my side. Now, if I, there are a few more questions, I'll see these questions. can this anomaly be rectified by the finance bill 2022? That's a very contentious question in my view. An action which has already got time bar under a particular law that gives a vested right to the assessee. And therefore, once that vested right is achieved, that action is getting time barred. A new law cannot bring about or revive that matter retrospectively. So in my view, that cannot be cured by Finance Bill 2020. Next question is about what is the remedy to assessee at the moment till the writ in High Court is settled. Meanwhile, file the letter with objection as explained by you and file return under Section 148. Now see, because these are lots of notices issued under 148, and as Sharad Bhai pointed out in his introductory remark, that for all assessees, it may not be feasible to file a writ petition. So of course, it will all depend upon what was the issue involved and what is the stake involved. If the issue and stake is commensurate enough, then assessee may think of filing writ petition, challenging the very issue of notice but under 148, under the old law, after 1st of April 21, without following the procedure under 148A, on various grounds, without even filing the return of income. However, this may not be feasible for everyone, and in cases where writ petition is not filed, at least this objection must be filed with the assessing officer. And therefore, when you are filing return under Section 148 in response to the notice which has been issued, immediately after filing that return, you should write to the assessing officer that this return is filed without prejudice to assessee's objection that this notice is without jurisdiction as it has been issued under a non-existing law. This objection should be filed with the assessee. If you file the return under Section 148 and also seek for the reasons recorded by him, and then when you are raising your final objection against the reason, there you may take up even these legal issues about the validity of the very notice under 148 along with your objection on the merits of the case. And next is whether notice under 148 be issued for reassessment completed under 143 for AY 1718 for some reason. Of course, under the existing law on 31st of March, subject to the first proviso which I just now discussed, this can be done. If notice under 148 for AY 2014-15 was issued on 25th of May but unable to file return due to technical issue with new tax portal, already written mail for adjournment but till date no reply, so how to file such return? I believe from today onwards the portal has started accepting the return. I have been informed by my colleagues that in response to 148 today the return filing has been enabled, so obviously they are also aware about the hitches in this new portal, so not to worry that the 30 days time limit has expired. Presently, no scheme for faceless reassessment is prescribed. The order of reassessment, I believe, is quite a long question. Order of reassessment is ultimately passed either under 143 or under 144, read with 147. 144B1 provided assessment under 143.3, 144 to be made in faceless manner. 144B1 provides that notice under 143.2 shall be served by NFSE. Also provided where assessee has furnished ROI against 148, the NFSE shall inform assessee that further procedure shall be completed in faceless manner. Query. So presently when reopening notice is received either under old new regime, subsequent actions of 143D etc. should be done in faceless manner by NFSE. Yes, it will be done by faceless manner, and don't worry, by the time this procedure progresses, they will come out with that notification under Section 151A. Nilesh, by all the queries in the chat box I have already answered. Now, yes, if any participant wants to orally discuss something, we can go ahead, take the discussion. But before closing, I would like to thank my colleague Shashank Mehta and Advocate Radha Halpe, who has helped me in making this presentation. And because of them, I have been able to make this presentation. And I am also thankful once again to the study circle as well as all the participants for the patient hearing. Thank you very much. Over to you, Nilesh.
Yeah. Yes, Sharad.
Yeah. Thank you, Devendraji, for a very elaborate and detailed analysis of the new procedure as well as the, I think, with this your presentation, many of our colleagues or our friends will have a little bit relief that even if the notice has been issued, if they apply or reply properly, they will be saved off. I am also thankful to Mr. Shashank, who has helped you a lot. Now I request our CA, Dipen Sumaria, to present a well-deserved vote of thanks.
Thank you, Sharad sir. Thank you, Devendra sir, for first of all for accepting our invitation on a short notice and spending your valuable time with us. It is always a pleasure hearing you virtually as well as physical. You have explained us the revised provisions of assessment proceedings under Section 148 in detail. You have taken us through the issues which would be arising on account of this new revised provisions. Thank you for sharing the material as well. It would be useful for our members in further assessment proceedings in replying to the notice. Thank you, sir, for your valuable time. I will request everyone to greet him with a loud applause.
My pleasure.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Can we end the session?
Yeah, we conclude the meeting.
Thank you. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.